Well, good evening. Glad that you would be here to join us in our service tonight. So good to see each one of you. And glad that you would come out, be a part tonight of what God's doing, what God wants to do. I'm going to ask if you would stand with me. We want to go to the Lord in prayer, lift Him up, exalt Him tonight, just to pray over every part of our service and invite His presence here tonight in a special way to minister to us. God's concerned. God knows your need. I know there's many needs we've been sharing with our local body here and those that very close to us that need a touching body and need healing. I do want to continue to ask that you would pray for Philip Etheridge. I just left him, actually, his home this evening, and him and Sharon, and they are asking us to pray and believing and knowing that we will, and we're doing that. So just hold him up in prayer, and Sharon, and as well as the others and the needs I'm sure that you would have. Would you agree with me tonight? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. He hears us. He's listening. He's concerned tonight. And He is concerned about you and those needs that are upon your life. So let's agree together. Father, we come to you tonight. Precious name of your Son, Jesus. You've made a way that we can enter boldly into the throne of grace. You've made a way that we can approach you, walk right into your presence, talk to you, fellowship with you, cast our cares on you. And God, we do that tonight, God, with complete trust and confidence in you. And God, we just ask that you would minister to the needs, God, among our local body here tonight, those that are in that place of needing healing, those that are needing freedom, those that are needing a touch in body, they're needing your strength and encouragement. God, we just place them before you tonight. You know their names. You know those upon our hearts. And we ask that you would minister to them as only you can do. God, we thank you that we have the privilege to worship you freely tonight, to honor you, to come hear your word. God, to come hear of great things that you have done, in anticipation of great things you are going to do. And we thank you for that. I pray, God, that you would minister tonight through Boo. God, that you would help him. God, that you would encourage him as he encourages us. God, that you would give him liberty, God, and freedom through your Spirit tonight to share what you have laid upon his heart. God, we thank you and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord, of praise, and we thank you. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. I'm asking our ushers to come. Wait on you for your giving, tithes and offering. Also, as I shared with you this morning, we want to be a blessing to Shayla and Tess and their new child, Eb, and we're thankful for what God is doing there and the healing that He is bringing. And if you would like to give, then you can designate that on your check, benevolence, and or put Shayler on it, Tess. We'll see that it gets to them to be a blessing in this place that they're going through with the financial needs there. So you can do that anytime through the church, and we'll see that it gets to them. Okay?
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today, and we thank you for this wonderful service we had this morning. We thank you for this evening service. There's such anticipation in the air, you could, light a light bulb with. And we thank you for both being brave and courageous enough to bring his experiences before us all. And we thank you for their challenge being here and seeing what an example he is as to what they're going to be. And we thank you for all that you do. And we thank you for this wonderful offering we're about to receive, and bless it, dear Father, in the name of Jesus.
While they're waiting on you, I'd like to highlight these announcements to you. One that I've been given today, and that is the funeral service for Pete Mavromatis, and that is going to be on Tuesday. Many of you will know him. It's going to be at Bethany Church, 2 o'clock on Tuesday. There will be no viewing, and you will know him, his wife, Jewel. Maybe that would help some. But the funeral is Tuesday at 2. If you would like to be there to be a blessing and show your support to that family, be at Bethany at 2 o'clock on Tuesday, okay? Also, want to remind you of the trunk or treat. That is this Saturday night or Saturday evening, 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock. A lot of fun things are scheduled there. A bounce house, there's going to be hot dogs, trunk or treat, a lot of things there for your kids. Want to encourage you to bring your young people and come out that night. Home Ministry Center in the parking lot there, and it'd just be a great time. So that's Saturday, this Saturday at 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock, okay, at the Home Ministry Center. It's another one I wanted to... Oh, yeah, and the annual barbecue chicken dinner that the school is doing annually, that is up and coming also November the 9th to help support the Christian Academy. If you'd like to be a part of that in your giving, you can see any of the students there or the leadership and buy the tickets. That's going to be November the 9th for that fundraiser, and you can be a part of that. Also, I just want to share this with you. Was reluctant to do it and probably shouldn't be, but I was, and I'm just going to share it because it is a community event, and that is going to be taking place. Actually, it started tonight with Manio Methodist Church, my home church, actually, and some of the other ones in here, and they are having a fall revival, and it's going to be different ministers each night, and tonight is Pastor Ken Mann from Bethany. He is there, and his singing group. Tomorrow night, I will be there along with our praise team. We've been invited to be there Monday night. So if you're looking to worship, looking for a service, then you can be there at Mount Olivet, downtown Manio, and our praise team will be there, and I'll be ministering the word. Sure, our local ones here, it's nothing you hadn't heard before. You hear me enough, okay? But I will be there, and our praise team. 7 o'clock. And then also on Tuesday night is the pastor in Ocracoke Assembly. Can't think of her name now. Williams. Williams is her name. Okay. She will be there. And then Wednesday night is Scott Hobbs from Liberty. And he will be there Wednesday night. So you have plenty to do, I know. But if you'd like to be a part of revival any of those nights, then wanted to let you know about that. Okay? All right.
Will you please stand, and we're going to enter into worship. I am just so thankful to the Lord. He's so good. Isn't he so faithful? Lord God, I praise you for your goodness. Lord, every praise belongs to you. You are worthy. Lord, you're a personal Lord. And I thank you, Lord God, for making yourself so real to us, Lord. Making yourself available and accessible. Hallelujah, Lord God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Thank you.
healer, restorer. Hallelujah, Lord God. Lord, you're a healer of bodies, but Lord God, of all brokenness. Lord God, a healer of families. Lord God, a healer of hearts. God, I praise you, Lord God, for your healing work. Lord, your restorative work. Praise you, King. Praise you, King. Would you thank him for that? Lord, only you restore. Only you restore. Praise you, King. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, King. You hold my every voice. You calm my raging sea. You are with me through fire and heat. Thank you. Indeed was worship. All I did was bow down. All I did was stay
about tonight. I really am, and so thankful that you all would be here, and I know Boo is, and the Dare Challenge guys and many of the other fellas that are in the Bible study that we have. So many of you I'm looking at there in the back, and that you'd be here tonight to show your support. And you know, there's going to be others that I'm going to be asking that are going to come help and share their testimony of what God is doing in their life. This tonight is called Hope Inspired. And tonight you're going to hear from Boo, who is going to share with you what God has done in his life. Some of you may have known the testimony, some don't. But tonight you're going to hear and see how God worked in his life, is continuing to work in his life, to help you in your walk and to help you to hold on and keep trusting him, keep walking with the Lord, to build your hope and to build your faith. And not only for maybe you that are going through certain places, this is not just to point out their challenge and the issues they're having. It's for all of us, because faith has to remain alive. Hope has to remain alive for God to move and work in our life. So this is to help each one of us in our walk, in whatever you're dealing with. And I want to give you this verse before he comes that really, I believe tonight, is really the whole thought behind all of this, and we hope to see happen in this, in your life. And that is this. It's in Romans chapter 15 and verse 13. Tells us this. Now may the God of hope. He's the God of hope. He gives hope. He has given us hope. And he wants to continue to do that. He's the God of hope. And it says, fill you with all joy and all peace in believing. He wants to fill you with all joy and peace in believing. He's a God of hope. And he says that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Tonight, it is a desire that God would move in such a way that you would abound in hope. When you leave this place, there will be a touch from heaven, a touch from God to you through the power of the Holy Spirit, that when you leave here, hope would abound. Hope would abound, that it would be stronger in your life. Hope for what? Whatever you need God to do in your life. Whatever you need Him to work out in your life. He is always working and He wants to do it. So this is the passage. This is what this is about tonight. That hope would abound in your life tonight in a special way. So it gives me great honor. He's traveled miles and miles and miles to get here. Somebody asked me, why are you back there and not up here? And I said, I'm waiting on the evangelist. I didn't know Boo was going to come. I thought he was going to back out on me. But he's made it. And Boo, I won't say I'm proud of you. I am, as his father-in-law. And I know his mother's here, Steve's here, and granddad, and just your church family. This is your church family, Boo. But he has a message that's going to help you. God has just done great things in his life. And Boo, I want you to come. He has the liberty, has the whole pulpit, everything, just to God. Give glory to God. God's going to move in your life. So give him.
Where you at, Ivy? He said that's all I did during Blaine's funeral spoke at. I just got up here for a minute and I forget to breathe sometimes. I'm trying to get better. I hope the more I get up here, it'll get a little easier, but it's starting off a little harder than I thought. So, but the Lord has done an amazing work in my life, and I just want others to get and experience the same freedom and joy that I do. And that being said, this is my story. Everybody's different, but ultimately, I just want to glorify God. So I need to pray. Father God, Lord, I love you. I thank you so much, Father God, for this opportunity, for working in me, Father God, that I could be up here to give you glory, Lord. And I just ask that you use me tonight, Lord, that you work through me, Father God. It's nothing I've done, nothing I can do, Lord, but it's all you. So I just love you and I praise you and give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Some may not know, maybe some guys from Dare Challenge, but my name is Boo Daniels, and I've grown up here in Wanchese and been a fisherman about my whole life. Growing up, I had good parents. I was taught good morals. I liked to work hard, to be respectful, to be a nice person. And even sometimes my granddad, he'd bring me to church. But how many of you know that when you get to high school, there are a lot of different pulls coming at you trying to get you to try different things? So, you know, it starts with a little bit of weekend drinking with friends. That may, then you start smoking some weed. Then before you know it, I was introduced to pain pills at about, you know, early 20s. And, you know, the enemy's never satisfied. He's never content, never going to stop, you know. So as long as you're giving him a little bit, he's going to take as much as he can. So by my early 20s, I was spending probably, you know, $100, $200 a day, or at least, you know, $200, $300 a day, probably taking 150, 200 milligrams of opioids a day. June 2009, I was involved in an accident. Some of you may remember. I don't know. I don't really feel led to go into it, but it really opened my eyes. And the accident was caused because I was under an influence. And, you know, I realized I had a problem. But the problem is I tried to quit on my own. I tried outpatient rehabs, and really all I did was substitute one form of addiction for another. I met Kate, my beautiful bride, in the summer of 2010. And from fishing with my granddad my whole childhood and coming to church, what little I had, I knew that there was a better life out there. I just didn't really know how to grab a hold of it. I started coming to church every Sunday, and I really wanted to do right. You know, I really wanted to, you know, I could see ones that were, you know, walking it out, and but I just, you know, I would struggle. I would have a few good months, and then I'd slip right back into my mess. Earlier on, a lot of it I could hide from Kate, you know, she wasn't aware. And then as it progressed, you know, I couldn't. She didn't even know the struggle was as real as it was until, you know, well into her marriage, or I say well, you know, a year or two. And I just couldn't get away from that desire to get high. And, you know, it just, by the end of 2015, I was back, you know, spending $600-$800 a week, lying, you know, just about ruined our marriage, you know. I would lie about everything. She couldn't trust me. All the money we had, and even some we didn't have, I spent. And, you know, you'll find yourself in addiction that all you do is think about yourself. It's very selfish. I still fished, tried my hardest to uphold good character, but it was just all about the pills and drugs, you know, what I had to have, what I needed to get to keep so I wouldn't get dope sick. You know, I would, you know, if I had to end trips early, I would. If I had to cut days short, you know, I would do it. Addiction will take you to a place that you never thought you'd go, or turn you into a person that you never thought you would be. My brother Scott there, he gave his testimony Wednesday night for the youth, and one thing he said was, if you hang out with the wrong people long enough, you become the wrong person. And I mean, that's the truth, you know. And the reality is I became the wrong person, and I didn't like anything about it. You know, I wanted better. I wanted better for my family. I knew that I was supposed to be the leader of the house, but I was failing miserably. Transformation had to take place, and with addiction, you are so bound by your flesh, you don't know how to see past it, much less how to get through it. You know, I tried on my own, and anyway, I failed. But Jesus, but Jesus. I'm so glad that isn't the end of the story. So in January 2016, I entered Sand Hills Teen Challenge. And, you know, after trying it on my own, and, you know, for years, I'd realize, you know, I had to do something different, you know. I see guys that went there, you know, Matt had a huge influence. And, Sand Hills Teen Challenge in Carthage, North Carolina. And, you know, you're probably thinking, where in the world is Carthage? And that's about exactly what I was thinking when they dropped me off there. You know, where in the world am I at, you know? And but it was the hardest yet easiest decision that I've ever made. I knew I needed to go, and I knew that nothing I was going to do was going to make it. I was going to be able to fix it, you know. And God met me there, and that's where He delivered me from addiction. It didn't happen overnight, but through a process of being taught and learning more of Jesus. As I got closer to Jesus, I got further and further from my desire to use drugs. Pride had to go. You know, that's a big thing that we all struggle with, you know, but especially an addict, because, you know, you don't want to admit that you got a problem, you know. You don't want to admit that you can't do it on your own. So, you have to walk in humility, and that's when Jesus will do His work. I love what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12:9 when he's talking about the thorn in his flesh. As he prayed, the Lord told this to Paul. Each time he said, and the Lord told Paul, "My grace is all you need. My power works best in your weakness." And Paul wrote, "Now I'm glad to boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ can work in me." And I'm like Paul, you know, I'm glad to boast that I couldn't do it on my own, that I needed Christ, because now the power of Christ can work through me. And it takes that place of brokenness a lot of times to get to realize that, you know, you can't do it on your own. You know, D.C., you guys are here. I mean, you can't, you're here because you know you can't do it on your own, you know. And I'm glad you guys are here, man. Praise God. I had to get away from all the distractions and all the pull of the world. Without doing so, I would get consumed with worry, fear, doubt. And before I know it, I was trying to fix things all over again. But at Sand Hills, I was discipled. I was taught the word. We had daily chapel services, but along with that, we had group studies and personal studies. We were given plenty of time each day for personal prayer, time to seek a relationship with Jesus. When you get to that place of intimacy, it's amazing how He can move in your life. Got to know my identity in Christ, that I'm a child of God, that I'm chosen, that I'm more than a conqueror. Got to build a relationship with my Heavenly Father and experience the joy and peace in the Lord. That my sins have been forgiven and that I've been adopted into God's family at the high price of the cross. The deception had to be removed. You know, the scales that were covering my eyes that the enemy put there with all the lies. And, you know, you're never going to make it. You're never gonna better do it on your own, you know. They were removed so I could see through that, you know. I could see the life that God wanted and had for me, you know. I could see through the lies. You know, temptation cannot exist where the desire does not first exist. We can't be tempted to do something we don't first want. The heart has to be changed. And the only way to change the heart is through the gospel. Spend time with Jesus and He will change your heart. And, you know, James 4:8 is, you know, draw close to God and He will draw close to you. You know, He's always right there. He, you know, it's not, if we fail, it's not because God is like, well, He stepped back and, you know, like He's right there with His hand held out. It's because we're not doing our part, you know. And a lot of times we know it may be in the head, or like we, you know, we know some scripture and you can quote it, but it's in your heart, you know. And just more than head knowledge. While at Sand Hills, transformation took place. My priorities changed, my desires, they left. And, you know, I had a different perspective. When I went to Sand Hills, I'm going to say it was probably fishing, family, and then God, you know. And now it's God, family, then fishing. And, you know, you realize what's really important in life, you know. And speaking of transformation, you know, in Romans 12:2, it says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. I mean, that's what I want, you know. Because His will, you know, is good and pleasing and perfect. So why would you not want that, you know? Before I went to Sand Hills, I would come to the altar and I would ask God to save me. But I would continue to get up from the altar and fall into temptation. You know, I didn't know. I didn't. Your flesh is so bound that you just, it's not long leaving the doors here, and then you realize that that enemy creeps in and you don't know how to fight him off. You know, you don't know and how to fight the tactics, you know. And in Ephesians 6, Paul talks about the armor of God and that it's made available to believers, but he doesn't just say we have it, but he tells us to put on the full armor of God. And I believe God wanted to deliver me every time I came to the altar, and he made the armor available to me, but I had to learn how to put it on. And I learned that at Sand Hills. God is wanting to do his part, but we've got to do our part too. He gives us freedom, but we have to walk in it. You know, when problems occur as a new believer and you don't know how to handle it, you know, then what are you going to do? You know, you're going to go back to the means that you know. You know, you're going to go back to the fleshly ways of handling stuff, and then you know, you're going to fail once again, you know. So and that's why it's so important for that transformation to take place. You know, I say all that about Sand Hills and how God changed my life there, but that doesn't mean that I came home, you know, and it's like, you know, I'm cured. Like, you know, God did deliver me, you know, he healed me. He, you know, I have no desire, but the reality is it's a daily renewing of my mind. You know, it's a relationship, and I know that I can't do it on my own, and I need Jesus. And just like any relationship, if I quit talking and I stop renewing my mind every day, then I'll be right back to where I was 3 or 4 years ago, you know. I mean, that's just reality, and a lot of people don't want to really hear that, but that's the truth, you know, because it's a relationship. It's a daily renewal, you know. And, I mean, before I leave my house every morning to go fishing or to go do boat work, Ivy and Scott know that there's a little bit of boat work that goes on there, so love you guys. You know, I'm up earlier, an hour earlier a lot of times, you know, to draw closer to my Heavenly Father, you know, because I know that and that doesn't mean that you're going to make it every day. I mean, that, you know, I strive to, you know, but it's just that relationship, you know, you have to put the time in. So, and if I don't make the time, then the enemy is always there trying to slip in and steal my joy, you know. And I'm not saying any of this to brag about anything that I'm doing or that, you know, I'm some great Christian, because that's not it at all, you know. I'm saying that to say after 3.5 years of being clean and sober, I still have to put my time in to my relationship with the Lord and into renewing my mind. I can't quit because the enemy doesn't quit. If I quit, it's only a matter of time before I fall into that temptation. But like I said, to fall into temptation, you have to desire it first. And if your heart's full of Jesus, then that desire won't exist. You know. Um, And, you know, I'm about done here, really. I don't know. But, you know, I'm so thankful for the Lord working in my life and making himself so real to me and revealing more to me every day. You know, it's a peace and a joy that you can't experience through the world, no matter how hard you try, you know. And that's what I, when Midge asked me to, you know, to share my testimony, I'm like, nah, you know, I can't get up there in front of the church. I'm not, you know. And the fact that I'm up here right now and I ain't said but like four times, it's like, you know. But that's a miracle. So, but, you know, I was checked real quick in my spirit because it's like, you know, if I can encourage one or help one person, then what am, you know, why would I not, you know? So, you know, God has done a work in my life, and I want to share it because I want to give him glory, you know. And God, he, you know, where our marriage was broken there when I left Sand Hills, he's healed our marriage, you know. Kate and I, we have a better relationship now than we've ever had. You know, he's blessed my fishing operation, you know, whichever boat I'm on. I mean, we're very blessed, you know, and he's turned me into the godly husband and father that I know that I need to be for my family, you know. And, you know, now I have the opportunity to work with Scott and Ivy, who, you know, who have testimonies just like mine where God has done a work in their life, you know, and they've both been to Dare Challenge, and we get to... you know, we get to walk this out together. You know, we get to encourage each other. So, you know, it's just amazing that it's amazing what God has done, and I'm just so thankful. You know, and Dare Challenge, hang in there, fellas, because he's got great plans, man. I mean, it's hard. You know, I didn't really want to be there when I was there, but I knew that the time I spent there would you know, I was investing in the rest of my life. You know. So be encouraged tonight, fellas. I'm kind of excited, but I'm out of stuff to say here. So, you know, anyway, that's what my testimony is, you know, and I hope that it encouraged someone in here tonight. And I'm very thankful for the opportunity to share.
Praise the Lord. Now, didn't that encourage you? And what God's done for Boo, he can do for anyone. And I just want to ask you tonight, what is it you need God to touch and heal in your life? Is it your marriage? Is it your finances? Is it a relationship in some way? It doesn't matter. What it is, God is able to do it. And to encourage you to hold on. I know last Wednesday, or a couple Wednesdays, Dustin had Caleb here, McCall, and he just shared how God had restored and brought him out. And their challenge was here. And you know, it was such an encouraging word, just like you heard tonight. But do you know the very next day, someone pulled out and left the program. So, you know, this is to encourage you, if nothing else, hold on. Amen. Don't leave. Right. Stay in there. And don't give up and don't quit, because as Boo said, you can't let up, because the enemy does not let up. But God is able to deliver and set free. I tell you, I know what he's excited about, because he's excited about Jesus and what he's done. And I'm excited for him. And tonight, I just want you to come tonight. Maybe you need special prayer, and you were maybe like that gentleman that did leave. I believe he's going to come back. But he was in a low spot. And maybe you're in here tonight, and you're right there at that verge. Maybe you walked in here tonight, and you were at the place, you know what, I'm just ready to throw in the towel. The Lord wanted to encourage you through this tonight to say, don't quit. Keep believing, have hope, and trust him. And maybe you're in here tonight and you're right at that place and you want special prayer. It's not a time now to be bashful. It's not a time now to back away. But if you need that, come. And we want to just pray with you and just to encourage you in that and believe and trust God with you. Maybe you're in here tonight and you would just like to come and just say, Lord, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for what you have done in my life. That, as Boo said, I heard him say he removed the blinders. Man, we can all be thankful for that. I'm thankful he's removed the blinders. Aren't you thankful that you can see clearly now the deception of the enemy, how he wants to run you away and run your life? So we have so much to pray about, so much to thank the Lord, so much tonight to encourage others. And maybe you just need someone to agree with you in prayer and encourage you tonight in your walk with him. So it's a wonderful time right now to just receive prayer, encouragement, strength, and hope. As they sing tonight, if you want to pray in your seat, if you want to come tonight to receive prayer, well, Boo, I'm thankful for what God's done. Boo's going to pray with you. He'll talk with you. There's others that'll talk with you and help you tonight. Let's worship him. Stand with me tonight. Let's worship him and move out tonight. Place, if you need prayer, come on, and we're going to pray with you in that place that you're walking. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. As they sing tonight, find you a place to pray. Find you a place to give thanks to the Lord. And if you need help tonight in prayer in some way, praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. As these come tonight, if you feel compelled to come pray with them, please do it. Don't let them leave or be here by themselves. Someone come and just agree with them, if you will. Pray with them tonight. People need encouragement. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. God, we thank you for this word. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You go.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Stay still. Oh yeah. Hallelujah.
introduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. When I thought I lost me, you know where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. When I thought I lost me, you know where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. Hallelujah, you have saved me. It's so much better your way.
Like we came, right? So we're going to pray tonight. You can have fellowship with one another, show your love to one another and your support. I want to encourage you, hold on. Hold on. Hold on to Jesus. Pray with me tonight. Father, we thank you for your blessings, the benefits in serving you. We thank you, God, for your deliverance. We thank you, Lord, for your freedom. We thank you, Lord, that it is a better way in you. Thank you, Lord, for encouraging this body tonight. Thank you, Lord, for working a great work in the life of Boo and the life of others. Thank you, Lord, for encouraging our hope. And I pray for each and every person here tonight. God, that strength, that renewed strength, God would just stay with them. That renewed support that comes from you. God would just hold them in place. Pick them up daily. Encourage them. God, that renewed support that comes through your Spirit. God would just abide with them. God, let this word they've heard tonight resonate in their minds and in their life. Every point that he made, God, of surrender, of renewing their mind, of daily spending time with you. God, continually bring it back to our remembrance. God, that we would put it into practice so that you can continue that work in our life. We thank you, Lord. You're worthy of praise. We give you all the glory, all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Would you love somebody tonight? Tell them you're glad that they're here and encourage them in the Lord. Praise God.